Okay, now we're going to look at the storage appliance in some detail. First thing we're going to do is just have a quick look through the different menus that you see here at the top. You can see that within the different menus, can you see here, you have services, storage, network, etc. under configuration. There's a maintenance menu which allows you to do things with the system. For example, like do a reset, which is what I have to do every time I want to start from scratch, for example. I can create shares. I can look at the system status, a nice status screen showing various analytics, or I can generate specific analytics. Okay. Just let's get started by showing you how I can add a statistic, say a percent utilization of the CPU, and instantly I get a nice graph coming up. I can add another statistic like network interface statistics. And I can go on like this, creating whatever statistics I like. And using these little buttons here, these little icons, I can show a minute of data, show an hour. Obviously, the appliance would need to be running for some time before I could actually show these in full detail. Show a full day, etc. I can represent data by different types of graph. So you can see pretty detailed information is available. Let's go back, and what I'll do, I'll start by going into configuration and I'll create a user account. This, you can, the analogy would be just like creating a user on a Microsoft system or on a Unix box. So I'll click on plus, I'll create a user, ZFS user 1, local only, not on the network directory. Give it a password. These other things here require session annotation, would mean if the user logged in, they'd have to type a reason as to why they're logging in, if they had some sort of admin function on the storage appliance. I only want to use the user for authenticating when I access a share. And if I click kiosk user, that would then restrict what they could see when they use the browser interface to look at the storage appliance. Okay. So I'm going to add the user. Then I'm going to go into shares. Rather than create a single share, which I could do, I'm going to go into projects so I can categorize my share under a project, which will make it easier for me to manage a bit later. Okay. And I'm going to add a project called SkillBuilders. Then I'm going to go back into shares and bring up my projects, select SkillBuilders. Now when I create a file system that will be associated with that project, as you can see. And I'm going to create a share called reports, owned by the user I've just created, ZFS user 1. And here I can set my permissions, which you can see are Unix permission groups. And I can click on individual permissions. I'm just going to leave read, write, execute for owner at the moment. Okay, and there I've created the share. Now, you might say, how would you see this? Well, just like any other share. So if I go into a remote session, I'm going to log in to a local system. Logging in as ZFS user 1. So I've got the equivalent user account set up on my Solaris 10 system. Now if I do show minus E, I can see that the report share is exported. Now the default mount point, export reports, which I can change if I want to, but everything is shared from slash export. Okay. Now, in order to mount this manually, I would need to become root on my Solaris box and then mount an empty directory, and slash mnt, as you may be aware if you're used to Solaris, is always an empty directory that's handy for mounting stuff. Okay. Well, usually is. Or maybe I've already got it mounted. Let's make a different directory. That's better.
Couple of questions in the queue, Mick. Is this a good time?
Far away, Dave.
You're using command line now, and as far as the configuration that you did before, can command line be used for the ZFS storage appliance?
Yes, the command line can be used under any circumstances that I'm showing you graphical facilities for. In fact, the command line has more capability than the browser interface. Yeah. In this particular window here, I'm actually logged into a different system, so I'm actually accessing the share from a Solaris machine. And as you can see, I've mounted it, but if I CD to it, even though I'm root, it won't allow me. If I drop back to my ZFS user, and then CD, I'm in, because that was the user I used to identify the system when I created the report share. Okay. And just to show you, hopefully, I can make a directory. And there we are. Okay. I could obviously start adding data, but because it's an emulated system, the performance isn't particularly good. So, but you can see that I can indeed share, and I can access the share, and I can control access to it for a user and so forth. Yeah. Okay, if I go back to shares, there's my share that I created. It's important to note that if you imagine I want to edit that, and I can't see an edit button anywhere, if I point to it, notice how you can now see the edit. So I can go in and I can change aspects. I could add a quota, which is a limitation on the amount of space it could use. A reservation is a guarantee of a minimum amount of space, which is a ZFS facility in its own right. And I could add other facilities to that share, like data compression. Yeah. I choose from a variety of compression characteristics and a variety of other properties at the same time. Okay. And then click on apply to have those take effect. So lots of properties you can apply, or you can just leave everything to inherit from the main project directory. Again, this is a facility of ZFS where you create within your pool, when you're creating a share like this, you're effectively creating what's known as a data set, which you can view as a separate file system, which in itself has a whole variety of properties assigned to it, such that if you then create other things within it, those data sets inherit the properties of the parent, which is what you're doing with this button, which is a very powerful facility. Okay. I can do things like take snapshots. Just add a snapshot. Give it a name. What's today? Thursday, that'll do. And there I've taken a snapshot, just like that, of that report share. Which means I could refer, you know, anything that is now created will, you know, obviously be reflected in the file system. But if I change my mind later, or something goes wrong, I can revert back to this point in time. Okay. Bear in mind I'm doing this through the graphical interface, and in situations like this where I might have multiple file systems, I would probably be better off using the command line interface and the script to do things like snapshotting. Replication. So I can do a variety of replications, which somebody was asking about just now. If we go back to our share here, start copying the data across to the share, and then we have a look at analytics. We should be able to see, there we go, some activity starting to happen. Not an awful lot because I didn't copy very much, but at least you can see it.
Mick, any scripting capabilities?
Yes, there are. From the command line, there are scripting capabilities, certainly. Yeah, so any commands that you might input at the command line, you can script them. So you can do repetitive things. And there are control statements, just like in the shell programming language, that you can use as well. If we go back to shares, one other thing I'd like to show you in the last few minutes is if we look at configuration and the services that are currently available, you can see that NFS and iSCSI are actually switched on. Currently we only have an NFS share, we don't have an iSCSI one, but we might like to create a Microsoft share that I could access from my laptop. Okay. And the SMB service isn't currently switched on. So let's click on it. This is just the generic service that is built into the Solaris system these days. Okay. And when we click on apply, it says, well, you made changes, but do you actually want to, and it's currently disabled, would you like to enable it? So I'll enable it. Now let's go back to shares. Go back to our SkillBuilders project. Let's set up a new share. We'll use our original user account that we set up, ZFS user one. Click on apply. Okay, so we now have our two shares. If we go back to our Windows system here, go into network and map a network drive. There we go. I'm on a Windows 7 system, by the way. I can obviously choose the drive letter for which the share is to be associated. So let's try. I won't be too optimistic and use the machine name, although it should work quite happily. I'll use the IP address. And the show was holidays. We'll connect using different credentials. That is, different credentials to the user I'm currently logged in as on my laptop. And let's see what... Remember, click on OK, and it's now trying to connect to the storage appliance. If we go back to analytics again, we can see the graph of the the network and the CPU activity going on within the machine. We could add further statistics, you know, for disk performance, etc.
Another question in the queue, Mick.
Yeah.
Why is rollback time slow, and are there ways to speed the rollback of a large LUN?
I'm not aware that it is slow, Dave.
I'll ask for more clarification.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so here we can see the various statistics being shown. Don't forget, you can always look at the status screen to find out what's going on. Now, one last thing very quickly is I can log in on a command line. And I get a prompt. It's not a shell prompt. If I hit tab, conveniently it shows me all the different things I can do. So I could go into shares and then show, hit tab, and it shows me what I can do within shares. Notice the script option. CD dot dot will get me back up a little. So everything I'm doing through SkillBuilders, I can also do through the command line. And in actual fact, when it comes to things like scripting, I can do more through the command line than I can do with the browser user interface. Now, that's the end of the demonstration. I hope that's given you a bit of an idea of what the software can do, and also giving you a bit of an overview of what the hardware options are. So thank you very much for attending. Let us know if there's any more questions and we can get back to you. Thanks once again, and happy Christmas. Over to you, Dave.
Thank you so much, Mick. Fantastic demonstration and presentation. Appreciate it very much. Wishing everybody a happy holiday time. There's an outstanding question in the queue about that rollback. I'd like for you to email that to us. Dave@SkillBuilders.com is just a great way to contact me. Dave@SkillBuilders.com. I'll put it in the chat window here. And we'll get to the bottom of that. So if you have any further questions, folks, you can contact us via email or the phone number, which I'll put in the chat window as well. And everyone have a happy Christmas time and happy holiday time. Thanks for attending today's webinar. And thanks again, Mick. It was a great demonstration.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks, everybody. Bye for now.